people. I'm with my food writers. Makes me happy. So Jenny Rosenstrach, founder of Dinner, A Love Story, which is a terrific blog about getting food on the table with kids. She's also got a new book out last week?
Last Tuesday,
but who's exactly. counting? How to Celebrate Everything. Everybody here's got books out, which is great. And Michael Twitty, founder of The Cooking Gene, which explores your African-American roots and the African roots of Southern cooking. Afro Culinaria?
That's my main blog, yeah.
That's his main blog. And he's a scholar, converted to Judaism. When did that happen?
Oh, Lord, really?
Okay, never mind.
We're going to start with that.
His Twitter handle is Kosher Soul. We'll get into that. Now, remember,
we'll talk about the chocolate minutes. Chosen stuff later.
All right. His book is The Cooking Gene.
Yes.
All right, okay. And Molly Ye, a former percussionist at Juilliard, who moved from Brooklyn to a farm in North Dakota, and you began blogging and writing in that experience because there you were in North Dakota. Yeah, there you go.
Nothing else to do.
Molly on the Range comes, is that October?
In exactly a week.
In exactly a week, Molly on the Range. And you have a tattoo, right?
Yes. I'll show you later.
Okay. You don't even know what goes on in the green room with the writers when we get together. So we're going to talk about food writing. In all of this, the key component is communicating what's happening with all the ideas up on the stage and people out there in the world, which is really what you all do. And I think... Deb Perlman from Smitten Kitchen had a column in Food 52 recently, and she was talking about blogging. And blog seems so 2000 and late in a way in the YouTube generation. But you all, this is your form of communication. I can remember when blogging was, we would just, I know Sam can maybe attest this, we're like bloggers. That'll never get anywhere. Let's keep writing our newspaper. And now it's a form of communication. It's how we're learning to cook and communicate changes in food culture. So I just put it to you all, first of all, is food blogging dead or is it changed form or what does it mean to be a food writer? You jump in because you're next to me.
I will jump right in. I don't think it's dead. I think it's changing a lot. And I think it's almost impossible to have a conversation about food writing in general without talking about the influence of social media and how that's affecting the way we're putting content out into the world. I think blogging was so successful initially, I think, because we were sort of the voices that were telling it straight and we weren't the establishment. But pretty soon blogs became this, Pinterest-ready life and so aspirational. And then Instagram came and kind of was the next level of, this is the way people really do it. And now even Instagram is getting too super overproduced and slick. And so, I don't think it's dead at all. I think it's just that people are always looking for a way to communicate reality and the way people really cook, night after night.
We had talked a little bit about that return to expertise, maybe, and
yes.
that there is so much. I mean, we get stacks of cookbooks that people want us to review, obviously, and they're ridiculous. And I'm sure the recipes might work. I don't know, but they just seem like. They're either vanity projects or somebody
right.
knew it.
Uh-huh.
So who's teaching us to cook now? Is it cookbooks or is it bloggers?
Well, I mean, what we were talking about with the return of expertise, I feel like all of these, I think bloggers have done an amazing job of getting people excited about food. I mean, it's the reason why we're here and it's the reason why we've had a measure of success is that we can talk right to our readers. So they're all at the party, but now I think a friend of mine what Kim and I were talking about was a publisher at a major cookbook publisher, and she said that there seems to be all this interest in food, and everyone's sort of using their best friend's guidance to learn how to cook, but there's a real opening now to return to expertise and someone with real cooking technique and who can explain that. And I am not that person. I feel like I got to where I am because I'm pretending to sort of figure it out with everybody else.
Right, but you're an excellent cook. I mean, there's no, you know, your
Thank
recipes
you.
Work, right? You test your recipes.
They do, yes. I mean, I have,
right.
I don't always test them on the blog, but with the cookbooks I do over and over. I mean, there's a real rigor to the cookbook.
Right, so there is, so rigor still has a place in food writing?
Yeah, you can't, I don't think you can survive without.
Did I mention our app cooking, cooking.com? Oh, I'm sorry. Food blogging, you jumped in. You were just like, I have something to say and I'm going to do it on this platform, right? Michael, tell us a little bit about...
There were a couple problems. Number one, now we have, a good number of food blogs that do talk about cultural identity, especially from the perspective of people of color. Mm-hmm. But when I started this, it was like, no, tell us about the food. Everybody wanted me to do—
Can you make fried chicken?
Well, you know what they wanted? They wanted a food porn blog with soul food. And I said, I refuse to be a refugee from an Uncle Ben box. Mm-hmm. So y'all gonna have to change that around because I'm so tired of that. And I wanted to talk about— everybody romanticized everybody else's tradition. Now we've come to where different regional Indian cuisines are romanticized, and Thai. Well, we've been here for 400 years. Mm-hmm. We built— James Hemings Hercules built the American table. We were the cooks at Delmonico's and Gage and Tolner. That was us. It still is in many cases. And certainly throughout the South, this billion-dollar industry called Southern food. And no one was speaking to that heritage and that history, but not just that, but where it fits into a contemporary lens. Because once you go to Atlanta and you see the Habesha and other organizations in the, you know, the inner city and the black community that have done for self, that have created urban gardening programs without the help of anyone else who are self-sustaining these projects. Forget the one that's down by the King Center that the guy used to work for Clinton.
Oh,
does.
Yeah.
Truly Living
yeah,
Well.
Yeah, right, thank you.
So you have all these massive projects that are not on the radar of other people, and I want to shine a lens on them and do it in the context of this is part of a tradition. This is not separate from tradition. This is all part of one world. Of course, when I first started, everybody was like, how many black gay Jewish bears are you going to...
Well, it's a niche.
It's a niche, but but people don't understand the power of intersectionality.
Right.
Because I'm not just reaching people who are like me, or Southern people. I'm reaching everybody who fits. Like, wow, you're like two parts of me. I'm one part of you. That's great, because it's very personal.
And blogging gives you the place to do that in the way that it used to back when there was no room in traditional media for other kinds of cooks.
It's incredibly democratic.
Right.
But it's also put me at another intersection mm-hmm. of, you know, culinary academic stuff is still not firm. It's still shaky ground. You can't go to a food history program and get a food history degree. You can get a food studies degree. And so people are just starting to wake up to that. And then there was living history, which is alive and dead,
right.
Because we have computers. We don't need to go to Williamsburg anymore, although you should. To see how that works. Mm-hmm. So all these different parts are kind of like have been marginal for people like me, people of color, period. Mm-hmm. But now through that blog, I've been able to say, see, we're all connected. Mm-hmm. Health, history, public history in terms of museums and living history, culinary academics, and the practice of loving cooking and eating and sharing our culture with others.
How do you measure, how do you tell your audience? How do you know who you're reaching? So do you like follow your analytics? Do you care about that? Or are you just putting it out there?
Very much so.
And
I know that most of my readers are white women, mm-hmm. followed by black women.
Why do you think that is?
I don't want to say they get me into trouble.
Okay. This is a safe space.
But
you can say whatever you want.
I think that first of all, if any time I walk into a space of culinary food writers, is gonna be white women. Mm-hmm. I am literally the raisin in the kugel. And so, I expect that. I'm not fronting. I know who I'm around. Anytime I've been around people who do academic scholarship about food.
So it's white women.
And also living history and museum work.
Yeah.
So all these different pockets, that's who I'm coming around. And then black folks are waking up to this. Now it's like, you, Michael Twitty, and I feel weird about that. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm pretty much the only show
out there
that does that. And I'm the only guy willing to put on the clothes of enslaved people and go cook mm-hmm. at a plantation, and people
you
go,
explain
wow.
Explain to people, just as a brief side point, that you do living history. So
yes.
You actually go and cook in the style of
I was just in Monticello, for example,
right.
with Dr. Lenny Sorensen, who's an amazing scholar of the enslaved community at Monticello. Mm-hmm. And we were bringing to life the cooking of the Hemings family, who's had this
all
French and
up.
Southern
yeah.
style, cooked at the court of Versailles and came back to America. This amazing culinary story, right? he's the true culinary brains behind Thomas Jefferson's love of food. Mm-hmm. And so we brought that to light, but not only that, but the foodways of the enslaved quarter and Mulberry Row. So just so people have never seen that before.
Right.
They've
right.
never seen that. And so they don't, so when you have people who bring their children to see this mm-hmm. process, mm-hmm. it increases the number of African American visitors because they finally go, I have a reason to go to a plantation.
Right.
I have a reason to go to a living history museum because my child can see their history right. shown. So there's that commercial benefit as well.
Right.
That more African Americans are into food writing now, more African Americans want to start food blogs,
right.
more
right.
black folks want to hear about organic gardening and getting back to natural right. eating.
And you can find exactly what you're looking for in
yes.
a very unfiltered way. I mean, I've been kind of reading a lot with the black vegan movement and that
yes.
fascinating deep amount of writing around that. So it is very specific. And so people are coming to you for that. So the question is, can you make money off of all this? And maybe Ma's a good, like, how your blogging experience, can you make a living doing this? And what voice are you trying to bring to this?
Yeah, so my blog focuses a lot on baking. It focuses a lot on the foods of my heritage, which are Chinese and Jewish, as well as the foods of where...
It's a twofer today.
We're the entire diversity panel of the conference is right here.
So I'm also trying to learn about the food in my new community in the upper Midwest. So a lot of salads that don't have vegetables in them, and a lot of Jell-O and casseroles and Cool Whip and all that fun stuff.
Not that there's anything wrong with it. We're open.
It's a learning experience. It's a new community. And when I first moved there, I was working in a bakery. That was my full-time job. And I started blogging more and more because I hadn't made any friends yet there. So I didn't have anything else to do besides blog. And in those 3 years that I've lived there, I have begun to form relationships with brands. I work with Kerrygold Butter, California Olive Ranch, olive oil.
Did you just get paid for saying that?
No, sorry. No, I didn't.
No, it's okay. I'm kidding. You should be,
not sponsored.
Yeah. But talk to us just for a second about how that works. So, as we were having this discussion, so you will you'll sign a contract with Kerrygold Butter,
right.
which is a very fine butter, in my opinion. I don't get paid for that. But so you'll sign a contract, and then you will create a recipe and mention Kerrygold Butter in the recipe, and
right.
then possibly mention it in your blog post?
Right, yeah. So I do a lot of cakes. I do a lot of baking on the blog. And so I'm using butter anyway. And so Kerrygold approached me, and they said, hey, do you want to use our butter in a few of your posts? We'll send you a truckload of butter. And
so you're getting paid in butter.
And money. Butter and money.
Butter and money.
Yeah.
Guns and money. Guns and butter. So, and how much, what, and you know, obviously, well, so how much do you make off of a contract with, just going to ask the question. Like, is that lucrative?
Sure,
like, do you need to have several of them? How much is a Kerrygold contract for a year? For
well, I guess, a really changing platform right now, just because 3 years ago, a blog post that might cost... I would have charged maybe $300 for one post to mention one brand in the post and all over social. Now bloggers are charging closer to $4,000 to $5,000.
Are you kidding?
For one blog.
I resign, Sam. I'm going to go. Dang. Did I mention how much I like Kerrygold butter?
But it's
that's lucrative.
It's pressure, though, because I need to make sure that I'm doing that, like, work that's worth that much. And I think brands are trying to figure out, you know, is this really worth it? It's mm-hmm. right now we're kind of in this experimental changing phase of, you know, do audiences trust bloggers more, or do they trust traditional advertising? And
that's
right now we're kind of in this great time for food bloggers because all of these companies are feeling like, oh yeah, bloggers are some of the first line of defense between us and our audience and our customer base. So right now they're really expanding their blogger sponsorships. I got to go to Ireland to visit the Kerrygold cows and to really learn about it, to really become an ambassador for butter.
But can I trust, like, I'm like, she's getting money. How do I know Carol Gold's a good butter? You're getting money for it.
So that's the challenge that I think all bloggers face, is how do you find that fine line of, you know, really working with a product that you believe in and showing that, but also, you know, like, you're also getting paid for it, so you really have to be careful with how you disclose that. Mm-hmm. And I get, occasionally we'll get comments from people yelling at me that it just seems too sponsored and that I'm trying to sell it too hard. Yeah. And other people that are really happy that I'm working with a brand like King Arthur Flour that they love and that they're excited to see new ways to work with those products.
Yeah. Now, Jenny, would you go to Ireland for Kerrygold butter?
I should say that I'm probably the idiot in this. I had no idea that's how much they were charging.
You will not. Listen, you and me both. We're starting a blog today.
Yeah, so, no, yeah. I do partnerships. I don't, but I outline, my contracts are all different. But because I have this background in traditional media, I'm very wary. I'm just uncomfortable doing sponsored posts. I do a lot of other things, like there will be a traditional ad in the side rail of my blog, or I will I'll do giveaways, just saying, you know, this company has come in and, you know, we'll give a pizza kit away to the first.
And you're on the board of Applegate, is that right?
I'm on blog panels or blog. There's a word for it. But yeah, so Applegate is one of these sponsors. So they pay me, depending on, the contract is different every year. So 1 year it was, I needed to do a giveaway, I needed to have an ad on the side rail, and I needed to tag them on Instagram with one or two posts. But they wanted a sponsored post, and the contract would have been a lot more with a sponsored post. But I think because of my background in traditional media, I still really, you know, I grew up in magazines where
separation of church and state.
There was an editorial and there was advertising literally physically in the building, and it was really, it's hard for me to move on from that. And again, I'm probably.
Right. I mean, that's a very different, my model obviously is I never need to really talk about it. I mean, I have the luxury of that because I work for the news organization I work for, but it's a different game. And, you know, now would you go to Ireland on the Kerrygold butter? What if it turned out that Kerrygold had done some really bad stuff to your people? Would you take the Kerrygold butter? Which is likely. Well, not, you know, I love Kerrygold. I'm sure it's a great product.
Seeing that I'm part Irish, I'd love to go back to Ireland. But I think for me, the issue is that my blog is known for the first direction is go raise a Dominica hen. You know, go plant some Sea Allen Redfield peas. Mm-hmm. I'm really, and part of it's because African Americans are great consumers, but we're not great conservers. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted our people to be able to be more self-sustaining. Right. I mean, that's part of our food tradition. It was our grandparents talking about how they fed themselves. Mm-mm, no one else did it for them. It's that the pride, the brag, they used to brag, and if I can tell it is what it is. All of our elders said that during the Depression, the white folks came to their back door because they're the ones who had the food. Mm-hmm. Because if nothing else, despite being sharecroppers, despite eking onto a piece of land that they owned, despite being poor, they always knew how to grow their own food. They had done it for centuries. Mm-hmm. So this idea of getting people to, Killer Mike even did a piece recently that's gone viral saying, how can you black folks be revolutionary when we can't grow our own food? Mm-hmm. So I've always been that kind of person where I'm just like, no, the first step is you're going to figure out how to have a garden. I put instructions or links. And then if you want to plant our traditional heritage plants, all 200 varieties that I've identified, here, this is how you do it.
So Anson Mills or somebody might be a good...
Yes, but I want a company that's owned by us.
I see.
FUBU. So for us, by us.
Right.
And so that's why I support Matthew Rayford and Denzel Mitchell and other growers of color. Yeah. Because when they get to
these
a point
Southern
where
Southern farmers,
who right? Are, yeah. And I forget the wider what the acronym is for their organization that does that. SAFON.
Yeah.
When we get those kind of folks get to the point where they can not just grow to for their farm, but actually begin to sell, then I'll do that.
Right.
Because I believe in cooperative economics. Right. Like any good yid, but yeah. Some of y'all got that, uh-huh. Right? Mm-hmm. Wink, wink.
Here in New York.
So the bottom line is that I want my community to be just like every other community, mm-hmm. to be self-sustaining, self-supporting. And when we have what we need for ourselves, then we can dialogue with other folks on equal footing.
Okay. Are you making money?
Hell yeah.
Okay, baby. Oh, we're going to have some questions. We have a great panel. So, you know, feel free. And again, the shorter your question, the more people we can hear from. So who's going to jump in here? Anybody? 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 Okay, right over here.
Hi. My name's Marion. I'm curious as to what food media you guys are most excited about and you guys consume the most.
Right. So what food media do you read, and then what do you think's like the cool thing coming up?
That's a really excellent question.
New York Times. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Always Wednesday is my favorite day of the week. You know, I'm so excited. Molly and I were talking about this backstage, but the cookbooks, this fall is an amazing season for cookbooks. A lot of big names are coming out with it. I'm so excited for the Dory Greenspan cookie book.
Go Dory.
I'm excited for Molly's book, of course. But I feel like, I don't know, I'm excited. I still think that, I think the food landscape has changed so much with social media that I'm getting ideas from all over the place, from, you know, those 30-second time-lapse videos that we all kind of hate but love to hate on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And but there, you know, you do you get inspired. I mean, sometimes right. you make something right on the spot because it makes it so easy. So, you know, it's not. I mean, the trick there is there's so many of them. So, like, as a food writer, you have to kind of step back and say, well, how, if in this massively saturated industry, how do you define yourself if this stuff is dominating the airwaves? So, you know, back to food writing, I feel like that's where food writing becomes really important in defining who you are. But yeah, no, I'm sorry, I didn't really answer your question.
Michael, do you watch the Tasty videos?
Oh, all of that. That's okay. Great. But, you know, for me, it's podcasts.
Okay.
I think 10 years ago or so, you know, people would laugh you at the door when you said it's a salable idea, a marketable idea to talk about food and identity and culture. Because everyday white folks weren't into that. But now it's not just people of color, but class issues. Mm-hmm. Appalachia is now rising as
big.
But they're taking on a model that was created by our folk. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea of we come from a place and a time that's often been ignored and obscured. And now we want to own it.
And we have to preserve our food.
Preserve our food.
Yeah, that's
right. And so now identity, culture, food is marketable, salable, and critical. It's inseparable from Black Lives Matter. It's inseparable from, you know, water is life.
Yeah.
It's all of that's connected. So for me, podcasts are a way into the minds and the brains of activists, growers, producers.
Because you're getting direct line into their brain and their voice.
And it's often I don't want to say unfiltered, but it's often very heartfelt.
A little more pure.
It's pure,
yeah.
And it's personal.
And trust, if trust is a thing that we're all about now, trust.
Yes, and so I get to get into them a little bit more and understand where they're coming from. A recipe is nice. It's a nice formula, and that's a good way to engage with people. But my recipes are going to teach you so much about me, as these two wonderful ladies own so much. Right. There are other parts of them that their work reveals that touches a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And that's why I like podcasts, because you get to those other parts.
Molly, mm-hmm. How about you?
Yeah, I think that's such a difficult question because there are right now so many different ways to experience food media and food content. There are podcasts, the videos, cookbooks, blogs, Twitter, Instagram, and then there's, you know, how do you know how to put your time into new apps like Peach or Ello? Because look at where those went. So I just love watching how audiences react to all these different mediums. And it's crazy to think about how 4 years ago a blog post is now something that's more appropriate for Instagram, like just one picture with a little caption. Or Twitter is just, I love reading Twitter because people are, it's similar to podcasts and that people are so off the cuff, mm-hmm. and they're really, you just have a direct line to their brain and you can post it immediately. I think it's really important to kind of keep a finger on all of these different types of media because there are just so many ways to kind of show what you want to show now. And it's a little bit easy to look at the changing face of food writing and look at how food writing
physically looks so different today than it did 5 and 10 years ago. But I think the best way forward is just to embrace the change and to get really excited about these new mediums and the fact that we have such a much bigger audience than we did. It's because of all of these new mediums, and right. It's like picking a favorite child or a favorite chicken. Like, I don't want to, I don't want to pick a favorite type of medium.
Okay, yes, right here, and then right next to you, and then we'll try to hit.
So, following up, I'm a pediatrician. I was wondering on the previous talk on health, how would you incorporate food and health writing, or food writing and health?
Is there an? It looks at all these intersections. So, food and health, health of the earth, health of our bodies.
And what you're promoting in your blogs? How would you?
Does health matter to you guys? You're not health. Is that a specialty? Health writing, or is it incorporated?
I will say that a lot of my writing I do, I use the dinner table to be the lens through which I'm writing about.
You write about family life.
And I write about family, and I think it's very, I don't kind of hit people over the head with health issues, but I think the idea, if you can inspire people to make meals most of the time that are wholesome and you're sitting around with your kids and there's a natural launching point to discuss, you know, where that food is from, and you know, why it's good for you. I mean, those conversations, it's not like we sit down at dinner and we have that conversation, but it naturally comes up. And so for me, that's a very important way to get people to talk about health issues without really being very homeworky about it and making it kind of fun.
I'm gonna let us jump to another question, let you guys take one of those other ones. There's a couple other people, so yeah.
This is from Michael. How can you reach people who I think would particularly benefit from a new approach of thinking about food, such as low income, often mothers who are working shifts, who don't have the time necessarily to really, you know, sort of be browsing through the blogs, but maybe could listen to a podcast while doing their shift work?
So what I do is, I routinely write pieces that are, lack of a better term, class focused. Because I realize that a lot of people who read me and just kind of like, they you know, looking through the panes, window panes, don't have a lot. Mm-hmm. And they want to know, how do I cook in my community? So they're regular posts where I'm just like, no, this is not about anybody, but how to survive. How do you get the most out of a very little bit? How do I give my children or my school international eating on a budget? So I often give those opportunities because I realize not everybody has that. And I did want to kind of just quickly go on the health thing.
Okay, sure.
Because I think that a lot of people try to lug African-American vernacular cuisine with this idea of it's not healthy for you. No, the comfort food that was Sunday dinner stuff that became everyday food in a fast food context is not healthy for you. Collard greens, sweet potatoes, and don't give me that new kale nonsense. The new, you know, all that mess. This is part of a traditional healthy diet that is based in West Africa. And the fact that for so many years we were told, don't embrace that heritage, go away from it. You're not African, you're American, has killed us. And so bringing people back to their roots has meant that I, in a very subtle way, say, you can do this recipe this way, this way, this way. There's the vegan way, there's the meatless way, there's the full-on whatever way, but this is why gluten, sugar, animal fat, how these interact with your body as an African-American person who's more likely to be hypertensive, diabetic, and prone to certain cancers. Now, you make your choices, but understand everything in balance and moderation. And sometimes you have to preserve the tradition instead of, you know, hitting somebody up with a cast iron skillet so their head going, you know, mm-hmm. Thou shalt, thou should not, mm-hmm. but also keeping things in perspective. So that's what I do. I try to make sure that what's unique about Afro-Culinary is I'm talking to our people, our community, and beyond in a way that says, I hear you, I see you. I know that you may not be a gourmet food who has the money for everything. I hear you that sometimes you need food that's more appropriate to your health, you know, palate, your perspective. And so I want to write to you for that purpose.
Right, thanks. And Molly, I want to give you, since we're almost out of time here.
Yes.
Health, class, and even race and ethnicity. These issues, when you're writing a blog, are those points for you when you're sitting down to do your work?
There are so many health blogs out there, and so when I want to be healthy, I know exactly where to go. Right. And the way that I get joy is that I like making cakes for celebrations, and I like making celebration food, and so I recognize that it's not always the healthiest food, but that's not really my specialty. But I recognize that you should have those, you know, on your cheat day or on your celebration right. day or your birthday. And so that's what gets me most excited. And of course, I also love teaching my readers about Yemenite Jewish food or Libyan Jewish food and these different foods they might not be exposed to on health blogs or other blogs. And so that's really important to me. I love allowing people to have a great time with their food, and I know that they know where to go for the health foods too.
Right.
So
great. Thank you. Let's thank this panel. Amazing, talented people. Thank you.
Thank you,
thank you very much. And just a note,